Welcome back to The Breakfast here on PLOS TV Africa. It's time for Today in History, and we're going to be sharing with you a couple of things that happened on this day many years ago. I'm going back to 2010. It was on this day that former President Umaru Musa Yar'Adua passed, the 5th of May. It was, of course, one of those moments where Nigeria was a little confused, you know, the build-up to the eventual announcement of his death. He was a Nigerian politician, was president from 2007 to 2010, declared winner of the Nigerian election held on April 21st, 2007. On February 24th, 2010, he, of course, returned to Abuja under the cover of darkness. There was loads of conversation with regards his health. The state of his health at that time was unclear, but of course there was speculation that he was on a life support machine. Various political and religious figures in Nigeria visited him during his illness, saying that he will make recovery. If you remember, there was also a very popular phone call by former President Olusegun Obasanjo, where he said, Umaru, are you alive? Or are you there? Or something like that. I can't remember. But on this day, 5th of May, at Aso Rock, he was declared dead. The Islamic burial took place on the 6th of May in his hometown in Katsina State. And of course, the federal government declared a 7-day mourning period for Umaru Musa Yar'Adua. It also, of course, led to his vice president at that time, Goodluck Jonathan, sworn in as the new president of Nigeria. There was also some controversy and speculations of, I can't remember his wife. Well, you know, that the wife of the president at that time, you know, was, these were all just speculations, holding on to power, and didn't, you know, want Goodluck Jonathan to be sworn in. But of course, the Nigerian constitution had to come in play, and, you know, he eventually took over. There was, you know, the talks, you know, that his health issues were kidney issues. He had a kidney failures and some of all of that. But on this day, Umaru Musa Yar'Adua passed. And of course, that was a president that many people have said, oh, one of Nigeria's finest presidents, one of Nigeria's best presidents.
He
only
got
to serve 3 years. I mean, you'll never know, you know, and you'll never really know until, you know, the end of a person's tenure, at least a couple of years into the tenure. But it was a peaceful time in Nigeria, I believe. Also was one of those, I think it was a period where amnesty for Boko Haram, not Boko Haram now, Lord have mercy, for MEND was discussed and, of course, it was given.
Wow. So we remember when, you know, back in 2009, November, when he was lifted out of the country, health issues.
Turai was her name.
Sorry?
Never mind. Go ahead.
Okay. Were you talking about the wife?
Yes.
Okay. So we know the agitation then. People were really concerned. They wanted to know what was wrong with the president. So I think this whole, you know, the secrecy surrounding his illness, how he traveled out, how he came back secretly, how we found out he eventually passed, you know, based on history, we shouldn't be surprised when Nigerians are really interested in the health of the president, because they've seen this happen before.
Yeah.
So when you say the president is going for a routine medical checkup, he's going to London.
And his health is his personal business.
Exactly. So Nigerians become apprehensive. They say, remember 2009, what happened? And, you know, the presidential aides are not saying anything. We don't know the nature of the president's illness. We have no idea if he just has a headache, if it's just maybe a severe form, if it's a migraine. We have no idea what it is. So I think the presidency should better understand where Nigerians are coming from. We've seen this happen before.
Yeah.
So we want to know what happened, what is happening with the health of our president. And we want to trust that the, you know, security and welfare of our nation is in a health of, or is in the hands of, a healthy person.
Absolutely.
So he passed. You know, people, like you said, have praised him for being one of the best presidents of the country. They talk about how fuel price was cheap, this, that, security was great. You know, but obviously people would always criticize you when you're there. And it's when you're no more, like you mentioned, people will now look back and say, oh, that wasn't so bad. Look at Goodluck Jonathan. He was heavily criticized. He left the country, rather, he left the presidency and someone else took over. And people were like, wow, we never knew this man was this fantastic, you know? So who knows what we might say about the president, Muhammadu Buhari? Who knows what the future would hold? Who knows if it would get better or worse? And you say, oh, Buhari was the best president we ever had. You cannot make such...
No.
You cannot make such predictions.
I don't know if that's a good prayer for Nigeria.
But you have to understand that the times we live in is different. It keeps changing. So the economic time and the security time off Yar'Adua was totally different than what Nigeria is now. Yes. We now have more security threats. Inflation is worse than the COVID-19 pandemic. So you can't exactly judge them on the same level because, you know, their reign or their rule in the country is in totally different, you know, time, different situations. So, but those basically are the things we need to consider when we, you know, try to assess one president on who's better and who's not. You know, but we know that today in history, he unfortunately passed on. We heard Goodluck Jonathan saying we've lost the crown jewel of the country. Condolences pouring in from different, you know, sectors, you know, of life. And yes, may his soul still rest in peace.
Absolutely.
So yes, also today in history, going back to the May 5th, and 2013, still when Boko Haram insurgency was still very fresh in Nigeria. We know that it was around that same time when Goodluck Jonathan, I beg your pardon, when Yar'Adua fell ill, that 2009, that was when we first saw, you know, any inkling of terrorism in Nigeria with Boko Haram's attacks and all of that. So this day in history, 2013, we saw that, you know, there was an attack on a church in a village in Adamawa State. Six people were killed in the market. Four people were killed around the church. You know, it was just such a dark day in history. You know, the Adamawa State Police spokesman at the time, Mohammed Ibrahim, you know, confirmed these attacks, but said, you know, we cannot immediately ascertain the motives because, like I mentioned, Boko Haram was still just on the come up at that time. You know, just a few years earlier in the year 2009 when, you know, they just started attacking Nigeria. So I did a time check and I found that just in that year 2013 when this attack occurred, in the month of January and February, there were about 23 attacks of the sort just in 2 months, January and February in 2013, about 23 attacks. You either found the, you know, Boko Haram terrorists kidnapping a Chinese person, blowing up a church, yep, you know, carrying out one, you know, evil or another. But it was just such a dark time, like I mentioned, in Nigeria's history. 10 people died that day.
Yeah, I mean, it was, you know, in those times, you know, that people were scared to go to church or religious, you know, buildings. Because you can never tell, you know, if, you know, halfway through Sunday service, there will be an explosion. You can never tell if, you know, wherever you are in Benin, you know, you might just be heading home from church, you know, and you hear that a bomb had exploded in Borno or exploded in Zamfara in Yobe. It was a terrible time for Nigeria. Those things have, you know, stopped, you know, and we no longer hear of bombings on that level anymore. We don't even hear of bombings anymore. Some people would argue that, oh, maybe because of the superior tactical, you know, power of the Nigerian
superior
government.
Firepower.
That's you know, why those things have stopped. Others would argue that, you know, tactics have only just changed and they've realized that they could, you know, do more damage, you know, with their new tactics now, and they could, you know, create more fear with their new tactics now. Now they're bold enough to attack army facilities. They are bold enough to
go to an army base, army checkpoints.
You know, and take, you know, ammunition and take, you know, gun trucks and whatnot. But it was a terrible time in Nigeria. Nobody wants to go back to those times anymore. But, you know, still, whether the tactics have changed or not, are we safer? You know, do we feel better now, you know, that there are no longer bombings? No. Now we're dealing with, you know, three, four, five different security threats at the same time. And we've spoken about this for so long. Tomorrow morning, very likely, we'll talk about security again. And, you know, I think you had mentioned earlier about the National Assembly and parents, you know, protests at the National Assembly. We shouldn't. And the way that Nigeria currently is, I don't think there's any other discussion the National Assembly should be having.
Do you even know what that means? You know, to basically come together, travel all the way from Kaduna to Abuja. That journey is even a security risk on its own, because what if something had happened on the way just to protest?
Yeah. Absolutely, you know, and so what do you expect from the National Assembly at a time like this? To plead with parents and tell them, don't worry, we'll look into it, or to go back and have this argument? I saw a PDP caucus, you know, led by Inaya Abaribe, speaking about a vote of no confidence in President Muhammadu Buhari and some of all of that. No, it's too much, you know, I don't think we should go into that this morning. There's no time for it. But on this day, 10 people lost their lives in a bomb blast. And of course, in 2010, Umaru Musa Yar'Adua, Nigeria's president, only about 3 years passed. Stay with us. We have a lot more of these conversations coming your way. How much padding has gone into the 2021 budget? how much money, is being duplicated in the 2021 budget, how much money has been spent on security or been allocated for security in the last, couple of years since 2015. Some of all of these revelations, budget has put out a statement, and we will be talking about that next with Sheun Onigbinde. Good morning and stay with us.